When you hear the word polio, your mind might first jump to black and white images of children in iron lungs, or maybe President Franklin Roosevelt sitting in his wheelchair. In other words, it might feel like a thing of the past. Poliomyelitis, the virus that causes the condition we call polio, is on the brink of eradication, and we have vaccines to thank for that. The first polio vaccine was introduced in the 1950s, and over the next two decades, cases of poliovirus paralysis dropped from roughly 15,000 per year in the US to fewer than 10. But it's been like 50 years since then, and we still haven't managed to stamp it out entirely. So in order to understand why, we need to explain a little bit about the vaccines we have at our disposal, and dig deeper into the history of the virus itself. Poliovirus has been around for thousands of years. Some archaeological evidence in Egypt might suggest that it's been causing paralysis since antiquity. But it wasn't until 1789 that a description of polio paralysis showed up in the known written record. In a medical text, the English physician Michael Underwood documented children who had developed a fever, followed by what he called, quote, a debility of the lower extremities. At this time, polio was spreading from human to human, like contagious diseases do, but the trouble it caused societies at large didn't really ramp up until the late 19th century with full-blown epidemics. And the reason why it happened at that point in history is a little counterintuitive. You see, a live poliovirus can catch a ride outside of the body via the mouth and nose or the butt, although it's much more likely that you'd catch polio from an infected person's poo than, say, like getting sneezed on. So scientists have hypothesized that due to poor sanitation, poliovirus was so widespread people often got their first exposure as babies, and that is actually a good thing, because these babies had protection. They acquired polio-targeting antibodies from mom's immune system while they were in the womb, and could top up while they were nursing. In many cases, those antibodies kept a baby from developing symptoms of polio while their immune system could create its own antibodies, which would go on to protect that baby later into adulthood. But the timing of this whole thing was super important. If a baby wasn't exposed to the poliovirus in the first few months after birth, maybe because they grew a bit of time and place with great sanitation and hand-washing practices, they wouldn't have a chance to make antibodies while under mom's protection. And then the first time they got exposed to poliovirus, their body would go into the encounter with an untrained immune system. The improvements in hygiene and sewage systems in the mid to late 19th century may have done a lot of good preventing the spread of other diseases while unintentionally increasing the chance of contracting polio to epidemic proportions in the early 20th century. So the question now is, what would happen if you came in contact with poliovirus with an untrained immune system today? Well, there are actually a few possible outcomes. Most likely, you would notice nothing at all. Around 70% of poliovirus infections are asymptomatic in children, with similar rates in adults. But even if you don't have any symptoms, you can still infect other people who could have them. If you did get sick, you would most likely experience mild symptoms like a sore throat and a low fever, and get better in about a week. Around 1-5% of kids also experience headaches, stiffness, and pain in the neck, back, and legs, and sometimes vomiting. Though definitely unpleasant and painful, most still recover fully in 1-2 weeks. But unfortunately, none of this is why the word polio evokes such awful memories. During these polio epidemics, a very small percentage of infected children developed flu-like symptoms for a short time and then got better. As a parent, you might have thought that your child simply had a cold. But then, a few days later, the child would develop a fever, severe pain in the limbs, and finally, paralysis. Adults who developed this rare kind of polio often skipped the flu-like symptoms altogether and jumped straight to the severe pain and paralysis. The degree of paralysis varied. Some would develop paralysis in the lower limbs, others would develop it in the muscles of the face and neck, and the respiratory muscles. These people often struggled to breathe on their own, and many died. In temperate climates, poliovirus seemed to spread during warmer months, so for many, summertime fun was haunted by the specter of polio. Meanwhile, in tropical regions, it was a year-long haunting. But hope came in 1955, when the first vaccine against poliovirus was introduced. Developed by Dr. Jonas Salk, it was given as an injection. To this day, the injectable polio vaccine contains an inactivated form of the type of poliovirus found in nature, known as wild-type poliovirus. The virus has been inactivated by exposing it to formaldehyde, a chemical that damages it so much that it can no longer cause illness. But it's still a weird lump of foreign proteins floating around around in your body, so your immune system will create antibodies to protect against any future wild-type poliovirus infections. This vaccine has proved incredibly effective at preventing disease, but some experts questioned whether it would offer long-lasting immunity. So research continued, and thanks to the efforts of Dr. Albert B. Sabin, a second vaccine was introduced to the public in 1961. This time, instead of getting a jab in the arm, you could take the vaccine in a drink, or even dropped onto a sugar cube. The oral vaccine was also different because it contained a live but attenuated version of poliovirus. An attenuated or weakened virus is one that has been modified so it can't cause the disease. Basically, scientists forced the virus to replicate in non-human cells in a lab over and over again. Because the poliovirus can only infect humans, this process causes a lot of stress on the virus, leaving it weakened. And then, when it's introduced into human cells, it can still replicate in the gut, but basically it cannot access and attack the central nervous system. And because it hasn't been outright damaged like an inactivated virus, the oral poliovirus vaccine elicits a stronger immune response. In other words, a person requires fewer doses of the vaccine if they get the oral version instead of the injection. That's a huge advantage when you're trying to vaccinate groups of children who move around a lot or who don't have regular access to healthcare. And there are also other benefits to the oral vaccine. Unlike the inactivated version, the live attenuated poliovirus can replicate in your intestines. That means a vaccinated person will develop localized antibodies in their intestines, which just so happens to be the main place where wild-type poliovirus replicates. So if that person ever comes into contact with wild-type poliovirus, the local immunity will prevent the virus from making it into their poop. Meanwhile, a person vaccinated with the inactivated injectable vaccine would be protected from getting sick from poliovirus, but could potentially infect other people. Finally, the oral attenuated vaccine can provide some passive immunization. A person who takes the oral vaccine will shed the weakened form of the virus in their poop for a couple of weeks. So anybody who comes in contact with that poop, say by accidentally swallowing contaminated water while swimming, has a chance of getting exposed to the attenuated virus too. Much like babies in the womb, they can develop a temporary immunity themselves. But despite all these benefits, the oral vaccine is not the perfect solution to our polio problem. For one thing, despite not having brains, viruses are pretty frickin' smart. And if an attenuated poliovirus keeps getting bounced around between a bunch of unvaccinated people, or finds its way into someone with a weakened immune system, that can cause problems for a lot of other people. In fact, that's why people who are immunocompromised are discouraged from taking the oral polio vaccine. Their immune system can't readily clear out the attenuated virus. And the longer it hangs around inside anyone who doesn't have enough immunity, the more time it has to change back into something that can cause paralytic disease. It's that mutated kind of poliovirus which can spread to other people. Scientists call this vaccine-derived poliovirus. That name can make it sound like it's the original vaccine that's causing the harm. This might sound scary enough that people think twice about even getting vaccinated, but you cannot get vaccine-derived poliovirus by getting either the injectable or the oral polio vaccine. People only develop symptomatic polio when someone else got an attenuated oral vaccine, and then that attenuated virus was able to move from person to person long enough that it had time to evolve the ability to not just infect but cause symptoms in an unvaccinated person. And getting vaccinated protects you from both the wild-type and vaccine-derived poliovirus, because there's no difference between the wild-type and the vaccine-derived poliovirus in terms of how symptoms develop. Just like an infection with wild-type poliovirus, most people who come into contact with vaccine-derived poliovirus will never get sick, while others will have flu-like symptoms, but rarely a few will develop paralysis. There are cases of infections from vaccine-derived poliovirus all over the world, including one case in New York in the summer of 2022. A 20-year-old man who hadn't been vaccinated against polio contracted the mutated virus and went on to develop paralytic disease. In 2021, there were only 6 reported cases of polio caused by the wild-type poliovirus in the entire world, but there were also nearly 300 cases of vaccine-derived polio. So if the vast majority of polio cases are being caused by the vaccine-derived poliovirus, which comes from mutations of the virus contained in the oral vaccine, shouldn't we just stop using the oral vaccine? The short answer is yes. But how we get there is complicated. Despite the risk of vaccine-derived poliovirus, the oral vaccine has several advantages over the injectable vaccine. Not only can it prevent people from spreading both wild and vaccine-derived strains and provide temporary passive immunity, it's also much less expensive to manufacture. Still, scientists and physicians recognize we need to move away from using the oral vaccine if we are going to entirely eradicate polio. The Global Polio Eradication Initiative has a plan to discontinue continue its use by the late 2020s. And many countries have high enough vaccination rates that they've already stopped using it. The US did so back in 2000. But communities with lower vaccination rates can still benefit from the oral vaccine. So, to help make it even safer, scientists have already modified the oral vaccine to reduce how frequently vaccine-derived poliovirus can pop up. You see, this continues to be complex. Wild-type poliovirus actually exists as three different viral strains, type 1, type 2, and type 3. Both the inactivated and the live-attenuated vaccines can be manufactured to contain all three strains. These so-called trivalent vaccines were in use until early this century. However, researchers determined that we had completely eradicated type 2 poliovirus back in 1999. That meant that the only thing that the type 2 attenuated strain was good for was potentially mutating into something that might cause paralytic disease. In 2016, the global health community switched the attenuated oral vaccine from trivalent to bivalent, so it only contained the strains for type 1 and type 3 wild-type poliovirus. Meanwhile, the inactivated injectable poliovirus vaccine still contains all three strains and still protects against all wild-type and vaccine-derived strains. If we want to eradicate polio, and we do, it's going to take everyone around the world working together. So you might be wondering what you could do to join this effort. Many people who grew up in developed countries receive all their poliovirus vaccinations in their regular schedule of childhood vaccinations. But if you didn't, it might be wise to talk to your doctor about getting vaccinated. And if you're a parent, talk to your pediatrician about vaccination. Because even though we love it when you watch our stuff, it's always a good idea to take any medical questions you have to a trusted healthcare professional. Thanks for watching this episode of SciShow, and thank you especially to all of our patrons who allow us to take on really big, complicated issues like this. You know, we have a range of difficulties of topics to cover here on SciShow. This was definitely a trickier one and took a long time to put together, so thanks to the whole team for doing it, and thanks especially to our patrons for supporting it. If you want to become one of those patrons and help support us making good science content on the internet for free for everybody, you can do that at patreon.com/scishow.